So I'm going to record this lecture, and I hope that it is fine with all of you. Okay, nobody is going to object this, because this could be useful later on. I will share this to all of you, and in future, if you'd like to refer this, then this could be very, very useful to all of you. Okay. So we shall now continue our discussion. In previous class, we talked about basic MOS capacitor structure. And for your reference, I have again, I'm showing that picture to you. Okay, so on the screen, you can see that the MOS capacitor is a three-layer device. Okay, the metal layer, the top one, then the middle layer, oxide layer, the bottom one is the silicon layer, semiconductor layer. Okay, so as I showed you, this metal layer, traditionally we call it metal, but it could be made of either metal or polysilicon. Okay, it could be a p-type polysilicon or n-type polysilicon, depending upon the characteristics of this MOS capacitor. Okay, the oxide we call here because generally we assume that this substrate is silicon, so silicon natural so silicon has silicon dioxide, natural oxide, which is silicon dioxide. So with silicon, it becomes silicon dioxide is an oxide. So that's why this oxide. Okay, this could be a dielectric too, other dielectric other than silicon dioxide as well. Okay, so if with silicon substrate, generally it will be silicon dioxide. If some other dielectric material, high-k dielectric material is used, then that is generally used on a pad of native silicon dioxide. So what is then done in that case? A thin silicon layer on the top of the silicon layer, a thin silicon dioxide layer is grown first. Okay, and then on the top of the silicon dioxide, we can deposit a high-k dielectric material. Okay, that will also act as a this high-k dielectric material it could be useful because its effective physical thickness, it could be have a thicker, I mean it could be its physical thickness more be will be greater than that of the oxide, and the requirement of this native oxide is to have a good quality of silicon-silicon dioxide interface. Okay, you will see later on that the property of the MOS capacitor as well as the property of the MOS transistor usually depends upon the quality of this interface, the silicon-silicon dioxide interface. If it is a good quality interface, the expected characteristics will be the characteristics will be better. If the interface quality is not good, then it may not work as a MOS cap. Okay, just I would like to tell you this fact that because of very poor quality of silicon silicon dioxide layer, the MOSFET was the first working MOSFET was fabricated in 1962. That is much later than when it was actually since its inception. This kind of device was thought of in 1930 by Linfield. Okay, but he couldn't get a good quality of silicon silicon dioxide interface, so he couldn't build a MOS like device. Okay, so oxide, it could be oxide or it could be a dielectric, and then this semiconductor. Semiconductor could be silicon or other semiconductor. Okay, so silicon is the most popular material for the semiconductor industry for ultra large scale integration at least. So generally in this course, our material for the substrate is going to be silicon. Okay, so you can go through some textbook and you can refresh the basic property of the silicon material, because most often we'll be referring to, or we'll be utilizing those property for the different kind of calculations. Okay, and then since this is a three layer device, and of course it's a two terminal device, the terminal coming out from the metal is called as a gate, the terminal coming out the semiconductor is called as a body. So we have gate body terminal, sometimes it is also called anode cathode terminal, but we'll refer here gate terminal and body terminal, because we are considering this, we are going to consider this in a another device, which is the metal oxide semiconductor field effect transistor, MOSFET device. So basically we are going to discuss this as if it's a part of a MOSFET device. So the MOSFET device has a gate terminal and the body terminal or substrate terminal. Okay, so that's why we are considering the two terminals as a gate terminal and the body terminal. Okay, gate and body or substrate terminal. Body terminal or substrate terminal and the gate terminal. These are two terminals for a MOS capacity. Okay, then we can now switch to the basic MOS transistor structure. Okay, so here is the basic MOS transistor structure, you can see, and all of you are familiar with this, but just to refresh the concept, I'm just going to repeat it once again here. Okay, so in this MOS transistor structure, you can see the MOS cap. Here is your gate region, the metal region, okay, or polysilicon region. Then below this, we have this oxide region. Okay, the region that is being colored now by the red. And below that oxide region, now we have here, you can see the silicon region. Okay, so those two terminals, gate terminal and body terminal, are still present here. But apart from those two terminals, now we have two additional terminals here. The source one, the source terminal, and the drain terminal here. Okay, so source terminal is not directly taken out from the body, but to get a good quality contact, thus to have a, you can say, low resistance contact, first a high doping region is created in the substrate. Okay, this substrate this region can be seen as an extension of original silicon. Okay, so original substrate. So in this substrate, high doping region is created. The two high doping regions are created, one here and at the two end of the substrate. And then from those highly doped region, the two terminals, source and drains, are taken out. Okay. Please note that, as I said, the highly doped region here means, if we are talking about a p-type, n-type of MOS transistor, then the substrate, original substrate, was p-type, and in the p-type region, we have created two highly doped region, which are n-type region, n plus and n plus. Okay, the order of the doping here in the source and drain is very, very high, of the order of 10 to the power 20. Atoms, impurity atoms per centimeter cube. Okay, in per centimeter cube volume, the number of impurity atoms present in the highly in the source and drain regions are in this order. 10 to the power 20 silicon impurity atoms per centimeter cube volume. Okay. So the source and drain regions are highly doped region, and of course, because of high doping, the resistance is very low, and therefore, when you take out the contact, we'll get a good quality of contact, and source and drain region with low resistance will not resist much the flow of the current. The flow of the current is not restricted much because of this low resistance, and thus we get this now four terminal MOS transistor structure. You can see the terminals are gate, source, drain, and body. Okay. So the two important parameters here for the MOS transistor, you can see, is the L, which is called the channel length. Okay, and the channel length basically you can see here is this. Okay, the distance between the source edge and the drain edge. Okay, the distance between the source edge and the drain edge is called the channel length. Okay. And channel length is, of course, maybe shorter than the gate length. Okay, the gate length is the length of the gate. This length is basically the gate length. Okay, which is represented here, which is referred here as a LM. Okay, and you can see in this picture that some portion of a portion of the source region and the drain region both are extended below this oxide region. Okay, so this extension plus this extension, this side extension plus this side extension together, these two are added, and it turns out to be delta L. So when the delta L is subtracted from the gate length capital L, we get this total channel length L. Okay, so please remember that it is not necessary that in a MOSFET, the channel length is always equal to the gate length. It could be smaller than the gate length. Okay. Or sometime otherwise, sometime you get a underlapped MOS transistor where the if the gate region is not properly aligned with source and drain. So it may happen that a portion of the, let's say that the gate region starts from this point and ends at this point. So entire channel region may not be covered by the gate. Okay. So however, that will be a MOSFET with very, very, very poor electronic characteristic. So it will be ensured always that the gate placement is proper. And that will actually ensure that we get a good quality of MOS transistor. Okay. And here, another point I would like to highlight that the substrate region is also the property of the substrate is also very, very important. And this is basically. This can be controlled just to control the electrical characteristics of the MOSFET. Okay, so substrate by changing the substrate doping, okay, you can change the electrical characteristics of the MOS transistor. Okay, by if you are using the 100 oriented silicon, or if you are using 111 oriented silicon, so in for the substrate. Then you see that the two crystal orientation have the different property. So to get the best electronic characteristic, electrical characteristics out from the MOSFET, what you do, you choose 100 oriented silicon crystal as a substrate. Okay, 100 oriented. So orientation here is 100. This is the crystal, the silicon crystal, the substrate, which is nothing but a silicon crystal. So this silicon crystal is basically grown in 100 crystal direction. Okay, why we take 100 crystal direction? It's very important because when we grow silicon dioxide on the top of this 100 oriented silicon crystal, in that case the interface quality is very good. The interface trap density remains very low. Okay, and low interface trap density are low trap charges at this silicon-silicon dioxide interface will ensure that the electric field lines coming out from the gate, going into the channel, coming out from the gate will enter into the channel and will control the channel charge properly. Okay, so that's why this 100 oriented silicon is used for the MOSFET fabrication. Please note that however, this 100 oriented silicon crystal is developing 100 oriented silicon crystal is a costly affair. Okay, but this is you can say a kind of must for the surface conducting devices, because the surface MOSFET is a kind of surface conducting device, because current has to flow at the surface of this substrate. Okay, the channel will be formed just below this silicon-silicon dioxide interface. Channel will be formed here. Is it or not? Am I right? In a MOSFET, the channel is formed below this, just below this oxide. Okay, so electrons, mobile carriers will be present here, and those carriers are moving from source to drain in vicinity of the silicon-silicon dioxide interface. So if this interface is not of good quality and the carriers has to move close to the surface, then the electronic mobility will reduce drastically, and the current delivering capability of the MOS transistor will be affected. Means the transistor may not offer the requisite amount of the current. Okay, so for 100 oriented for the surface conducting devices, I think I said that 100 oriented silicon is most suitable because of the less interface charge density. Okay, however, the devices which are basically bulk conducting devices, they are you can use even 110 oriented crystal. Okay, so they are growing 110 oriented silicon crystal is not as costlier as that 100 oriented silicon. Okay, so those devices that are built using 110 oriented silicon crystal could be cheaper than that of the MOS transistor devices. Okay, can you tell me the name of one device which is a bulk conducting device? Any one of you? Any one of you? Bulk conducting device where carrier moves through the bulk of the semiconductor. Bulk means, let's say that if this is our substrate, okay, so the carriers will be moving here deeper into the silicon, into the substrate, okay. More carriers will be moving through the body, okay, through so this is also called bulk. So if the more carriers are moving away from the interfaces, then they will show the higher electronic mobility, because they will interact less with the irregularity of the surfaces, and therefore we can get the higher equivalent higher current. Okay, so any idea about this? Any idea about a bulk conducting device? Any example of a bulk conducting device? The bipolar junction transistor, BJT. Okay, the BJT is a bulk conducting device where the carriers move through the bulk. More carriers move through the bulk than the carriers move through the surface. Okay, so this is the basic structure of a MOS transistor. I think now it is clear to you. Okay, If you okay, there is another one parameter here, the width of the transistor, so W. So again, you can see that the channel width, W is the channel width, the width of the channel, because you see that this is the inject direction. We have the width, I mean, the width is represented W, and W is WM minus delta W. So WM is the width of the gate, but the width of the channel can be smaller than the width of the gate. So that's why this WM delta W is terms is coming here, because you can see that this is one transistor. When many transistors will be fabricated on a single chip, then there will be isolation layer between the two subsequent transistors. You see that one transistor is here, one transistor will be at this end, okay, another transistor will be at this end, one transistor will be in front of this transistor, between myself and this transistor, another will be to the next side of this transistor. So of course there will be an isolation region between the transistor facing me and between the transistor on the screen. So there will be a isolation region, and there is a possibility that when we will place this gate, the width of the this gate comes out over some of the isolation region, that is between the facing transistor and this transistor. So that's why you see that this delta W terms appears here, and because of this delta W, the actual channel width is less than the gate width of the transistor. Okay, so with this we conclude the basic structure of the MOS transistor. Now let us switch to the electrical characteristic of the MOSFET. If you have any question, any doubt, anybody of you can ask, please.
Hello, sir.
Please. Yeah, go ahead.
Sir, is 100 represent the Miller?
Yeah. That's right.
Yes. Okay, sir. As the first one is for X direction, Y and Z direction. So, how is this structure of MOSFET is located? I mean, which direction representing X, which direction is representing Y?
You can say that X is along the channel length, okay. Y is along this substrate, and Z is you can see in this direction into this screen, okay. So this is your X, Y, and this is your Z. Z is the direction of width. Y is the direction of the depletion region, and X is the direction of the channel length. Okay. So keep this basic structure all of you in your mind. Okay. So we are going to work on this device, and future lectures we'll be referring this device again and again. Okay, we'll be discussing referring this parameter channel length and the channel width.
Sir,
any other question?
Sir, how you are saying that BJT is a bulk conducting device?
Pardon?
Sir, why and how you are saying that a BJT is a bulk conducting device?
Because the physics is different. Okay, physics of my MOS transistor and the BJT are the different. In MOS transistor, you will see that the channel is formed because of when you apply a gate voltage, a suitable gate voltage. If the gate voltage here is greater than the threshold voltage, then the channel is formed, okay, next to the silicon-silicon dioxide interface here, okay, at the surface of this substrate, okay. So when you then bias this device properly, when you apply appropriate potential between source and drain, then the carriers, mobile carriers, will be moving next to the interface. But this is not true in a BJT, which is either a PNP or a NPN BJT. Okay, in if you recall the biasing of the PN BJT, Okay, just I am drawing here a let's say NPN transistor. Okay, so sorry, let me draw here three layers. Okay, this is N layer, it could be emitter, and base layer in between, and then the collector region. So let's say that this is emitter, okay, and base, and this region is the collector region. Okay, so what you do, you bias this emitter base in forward bias, so base will be kept at higher potential than emitter, so it's nothing but a PN junction. Okay, and when this emitter base junction is biased, will be in the forward bias, the electrons from this emitter, because you are not inverting this emitter region, emitter is already n type, the whole emitter region is n type, the whole base region is a p type, and when you give the suitable voltage between emitter and base, the electrons throughout this emitter region will be injected into the base region, and whole from the base region will be injecting will be coming to the emitter region. Okay, so there is no restriction here that the electrons are present at the surface only and they will go to the base. Okay, is it not like this? But this is the case in the MOS transistor. MOS transistor is a inversion based device. Okay, so I mean if it's a n-type enhancement type MOSFET, then definitely it is going to work on the inversion concept. So the channel is formed, the conducting layer forms at the interface here, but in a BJT there is no such requirement of the conducting layer near the interfaces. Okay, here this whole emitter region can inject carrier to the base region and vice versa. Okay, so that's why BJT is a you can say a bulk conducting device, whereas this MOS transistor that we have talked about is a surface conducting device. Does it make sense? Is your question taken properly?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So now let's go ahead. Now we'll go to the next. Okay. Now we'll go to the electronics property of the MOS transistor. You call it electronics property or electrical property. Okay. So you can see the biasing of the MOS transistor. If it is an enhancement type MOS transistor, means with p substrate and n plus source and drain, so this region between the two source and drain are basically p region in this case, but when we apply a suitable gate to source voltage, you see that this battery is connected between gate to source. This is your source point. Okay, this is gate point. So this battery is connected between gate to source. Okay, and there is another battery which is connected between source to drain, which is VDS. Okay, so this is VDS, this is VGS. Okay, and the source and body are tied together here. You can see source and body are tied together. So both source terminal and body terminals are at the same potential. Okay, this is one of the biasing scheme. There could be even another biasing scheme where you can have three supply voltage. Okay, you can have a battery between gate and body, source and body, and drain and body. Okay, see that in this biasing scheme, the source is the reference. Okay, so that's why we have two potential: gate to source potential and drain to source potential. Okay, so this is source reference biasing scheme, you can say. There could be another scheme where you take body as a reference. So when you take body as a reference, then there will be potential like VGB get to body potential, and VSB source to body potential, and VDV drain to body potential. Okay. So even if you use this Weising scheme, the get to source potential in this case, get to source potential is, will be equal to VGB minus VSB, and drain to source potential will be equal to VDS minus VS. This is not VDS, this is VDB. Okay, so VDB minus VSB will be equal to VDS. So you can adopt anyone. So here the and you'll see later on that based on this referencing style, the models that are developed for the MOS transistor are different. So models that are developed with the source as a reference are called source reference models, and there could be model with the body reference which are called body reference models for the MOSFET. And sometimes these models are interchangeable, means source reference model, body reference model can be converted into the source reference model. Okay, so this is another discussion, we'll take it up later on. So here the source is taken as a reference, so we have a gate to source voltage, then drain to source voltage, and the current is ID here, that is the most important, one of the important parameter of this MOS transistor, you can see ID. So ID is the current that is going to flow between drain and source terminal. So what is done here, you can see that in this graph, the drain current ID is plotted against the drain to source voltage. But for this graph, what is done, the gate to source voltage has been properly chosen. You see that this is the controlling, this supply voltage VGS is going to control the channel. We'll discuss this later on how this is going to control the channel, but this is going to control the channel. So until your VGS is not greater than a certain voltage, there is no channel, and you can expect a very small current. Okay, so if VGS, the gate to source voltage, is greater than this certain voltage, which is we call it the threshold voltage. So if VGS is greater than VTH, and then if you keep changing, let's say that this is a variable supply voltage, and then you if you keep changing this supply voltage VDS, then this ID, the drain current, will be is expected to vary with this supply voltage. And this is the nature how the drain to with drain to source voltage, the drain current is going to vary. You see that initially this can be divided into two sections, this characteristic, when the drain to source voltage is small, okay, in this region, when drain to source voltage is small, you can see that the current initially increases linearly with the drain to source voltage in this particular region, you can see. Okay, with increasing drain to source voltage, current increases almost linearly. So this is also called sometime linear region. Okay, this is called linear region sometime, and then it starts saturating, and you can see that there is a change in the slope here, and it's change in the slope, and then when VDS goes above a particular voltage level, it almost become constant. Okay, it almost gets saturated. So because of this kind of characteristics, we can divide this region into two portions, the non-saturation region and the saturation region. This is the above threshold characteristic. Why above threshold characteristics? Because we have set the get to source voltage greater than the threshold voltage. Okay, we are considering that device is fully conducting, it's fully on, and then we change drain to source voltage, and we are observing the variation in the drain to source current. Okay, so initially it is linearly changing, so linear region or resistive region. And because in resistor you say that if there is a resistor, if you are changing the voltage, current will be changing according to the change in the voltage. Am I right? So it's, we have like a resistor, so it's a resistive region. So sometimes you will see that in integrated circuit design, particularly when you will discuss the analog circuit design. So there you need resistor. So sometime so resistor, if you fabricate a bare only resistor on the silicon chip, then it is going to consume much more area than a transistor. So a transistor itself can be biased in such a way that it will work as a resistor. So if you bias the transistor in the linear region of the operation, it is going to act as a resistor, and you can use the you can change the drain to source voltage of that resistor that transistor, and you can acquire the give a particular required resistance value. Okay, so that's why it's also called the resistive region, where you can use the transistor as a resistor. Okay, and then the saturation region, where current gets saturated. So once the saturation is reached, then you can see that the current is not changing. Ideally, current is not changing with the drain to source voltage. And please also note that this is done for a particular gate to source voltage level, VGS1. Okay, if I increase this further VGS, then the characteristic shift upward. Okay, so now the another characteristics could be like this. Okay, another for higher gate to source voltage could be like this. For lower gate to source voltage, it could be like this. Okay. All right, is it making sense? Okay, so this kind of output characteristic, this characteristics is also called the output characteristics of MOS transistor, which is plotted between the drain current and the drain to source voltage. Okay, so there could be another characteristics which is called the input characteristics, which is drawn between the drain current and the gate to source voltage for a fixed drain to source voltage. You see that in this case, the ID was drawn versus drain to source voltage for a fixed gate to source voltage. But if I fix the gate to source voltage and if I fix drain to source voltage, so here if I take VDS, drain to source voltage, and if I plot ID here for a not ID but natural log of ID, okay, current in logarithmic scale at x-axis, y-axis, then you will see that this kind of characteristics is seen, okay, which is entirely different from this one. Okay, this kind of characteristic is seen. So here basically the current changes exponentially with gate to source voltage, and for this actually the gate to source VGS is less than the threshold voltage. VGS is less than the threshold voltage, so transistor is off. So in technically it's in off condition, because you are saying that the threshold is that critical voltage that is necessary to make the transistor on. Okay, so if I keep VGS less than VTH and then I am changing VGS to I and plot ID, we get this kind of characteristics, and I call it the subthreshold characteristics. Okay, we'll discuss this about this later on in the detail. We'll take each and every section of the characteristics and we'll explore that. We'll try to explore the region, we'll try to explore the physics of that, and we'll try to derive the expressions. Okay, then the things will become more clear. Here just I am telling you because of some overall understanding of the MOSFET characteristics. Okay, is it clear to all of you? Any doubt? Any question from anybody?
Hello.
Yes.
Sir, you have shown P circuit. That means you have made NMOS. So in NMOS, current flows from drain to source. Now, current flow from.
Please note that this direction ID is a reference direction. Okay, ID. Just look at the direction. This is taken as a reference direction. So the current ID, depending upon later on, you will see that if whether it is a N channel or P channel. Okay, so depending upon the actual current, and this reference will consider the current as a plus ID or minus ID. Okay, but we are going to take this as a reference direction. Please note this, this is good question and good observation. Okay, please keep this in your mind. Of course, it is of course that if electrons source role is to inject electrons into the channel. Okay, so if the carrier's electrons are moving from source to drain, then the current is basically from drain to source. And from the outside of the device, it will be from source to drain. Okay, inside the device, it is from drain to source. So this ID is with the direction shown here is our reference direction. Okay, whenever the actual current will change from this direction, we'll refer this to minus ID. Okay. Any other question? Any doubt? Any other doubt from anybody? Okay, so I think there is no such doubt, so I will again go ahead. Okay, so let us have a look at the comprehensive characteristics of a MOS transistor. Okay, so here you can see at y axis the drain current ID is taken. Okay, and at x axis we have drain to source voltage, and this is for a wide range of gate voltage. You can see that the gate voltage is 0 here and 0 to here, you can see 1.5. so there is a wide variation in gate to source voltage, and the characteristics ID is drawn. Okay, so you can see that this characteristics IV characteristics is labeled here. The different regions are labeled: strong inversion level, moderate inversion level, weak inversion level, and the leakage affected region. Okay, so if gate voltage is very high, VGS gate to source voltage is greater than threshold voltage, you can say. And we'll also see later on that when the surface potential is pinned to a potential twice phi f, psi s becomes, surface potential becomes equal to twice phi f, then we consider the transistor to be in the strong inversion. Okay, so generally the previous characteristics that I have shown you, IDS versus VDS for a gate voltage VGS greater than VTH, was in a strong inversion region. Okay, in a strong, when the MOSFET is in a strong inversion region, that could be biased either in a linear region or in saturation region. Okay, so for a high gate voltage, this is strong inversion region. Then if gate voltage is less than that, then we enter into the moderate inversion region. Then for even lower gate voltage, we call it weak inversion region. And then when gate voltage becomes close to zero, this is the leakage affected region. Okay, so the nature of the this graph is a little bit different than what we have seen in the previous curve. Okay, just notice the following. You know that in a MOS transistor, what is the drain to source voltage at beyond which the currents get saturated? VDS, when VDS is equal to R greater than what? VGS minus VTH. Am I right? I hope that all of you know this formula.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So when transistor is in saturation region, okay, sorry, when transistor is in strong inversion region and it's fully on, gate voltage is sufficiently high. It's much larger than, let's say, the threshold voltage, you can say. Okay, then transistor will be in strong inversion. When it is in strong inversion, then if you plot ID, VD characteristics, then at x-axis there will be a point where the VDS value will be equal to VGS minus VTH value, because each curve is plotted for a given value of VGS. Let's say that the curve is plotted for gate to source voltage of 0.7 volt, and the VTH for that device is, let's say, 0.3 volt. Okay, so the VDS value will be 0.7 minus 0.3 minus 0.5 volt. Okay, minus 0.7. Let us see here in saturation. Okay, so you can see here that ID is plotted versus, so what is done here in this curve is basically go back to the previous one. Okay, in previous all regions are shown: strong inversion, moderate, weak inversion, leakage. So for a wide range of gate voltage it was shown, but in the next curve what is shown is only in the strong inversion, only per gate voltage much higher. Okay, so you get linear region first, and then you get the saturation region. So for saturation will happen at the drain to source voltage equal to VGS minus VTH. For example, if the curve is plotted for VGS value 1.5 volt, and let's say that it's threshold voltage is somehow somewhere equal to 0.8 volt. Okay, so the saturation will happen here at that value of VDS, maybe how much? Let's say 0.7 volt. Okay, so VDS saturation is equal to VGS minus VTH. VGS 1.5, VTH let's say 0.8. So 1.5 minus 0.8 is, let's say here, 0.7. Okay, so for the different value of VGS, you see that the saturation points will vary. Okay, it keeps varying. For lower gate to source voltage, saturation will happen little bit earlier. Okay, little bit at smaller drain to source voltage. All right. See, this is the characteristics of a strong inversion transistor biased in the strong inversion. The saturation point keeps varying with the gate to source voltage. Okay, this. This curve is representing the saturation point for the different gate to source voltage curve. Am I right? So this keeps varying with VGS, because VDS is equal to VGS minus VTH. But if you try to investigate the current saturation in the subthreshold region, where gate to source voltage is very, very small, gate to source voltage is equal to get to source voltage is equal to very small in this region, but in this particular region just look at the characteristics. Okay, so saturation point, you see the saturation point is almost constant. It's, this line is vertical in this region. Okay, so whether it is a gate voltage 0.5 or 0.4 or 0.3 or 0.2 or 0.1, the saturation current gets saturated at the same drain to source voltage here. Okay, current gets saturated here. So here you can see that the saturation is not gate to source voltage dependent. Okay, in this region the current keeps increasing with drain to source voltage, but when this certain potential level is attained, then current becomes almost constant. Okay, so this is a unique characteristics of the subthreshold region where VGS is very, very small. We'll explore this in detail later on, and we will try to figure out why this kind of characteristics appears in the MOS transistor characteristics. So we'll talk about this later on. Okay, but here keep these important facts in your mind, that when they will come before us for further discussion, then you will be familiar. Okay, and you will also understand the context why actually we are going to talk about this kind of characteristics. Okay, All right. So now we have reviewed the basic MOS transistor structure and its DC characteristics. Of course, these characteristics ID versus BD and whether it is ID versus BD or ID versus BG, we'll call it DC characteristics because the potentials applied here between the terminals, gate to source terminals and drain to source terminals, are DC potential. Okay, so we are changing this potential slowly, and then we are trying to observe the current variation with these potentials. Okay, so this is DC characteristics. We only investigated the basic DC characteristics of the MOS transistor. AC characteristic, AC behavior will be developed based on this DC characteristics only later on. Okay. So we have talked about the basic MOS transistor structure. Okay, but I would like to tell you that over the years, you see, first MOS transistor was fabricated in year which year? I mentioned this in this lecture. It was 1962 by Kang and Netela. Okay, and since then, this become very popular because of its excellent electrical characteristics. People started fabricating integrated circuits using those transistors. Okay, and then there is a important guidelines given by Moore's, Gordon Moore's. Most of you will be familiar about that the number of transistors on the chip will keep increasing. It will be double by every 2 years, then 1.5 years first, and then he later modified it to 2 years. So he said that in every 2 years, the number of transistors on a given chip area will be doubled. Okay, it means you have to reduce the transistor size. Then only if you can reduce the transistor size, if you reduce the area by half, area of one transistor by half, then only you can increase, put two transistor in the same area. Okay, so to meet the guidelines of Gordon Moore, to meet the Moore's law, which has been the driving force for the semiconductor industry, the miniaturization of the transistor started very early in 60s. Okay, so people tried to build smaller transistors. Okay, and over the years, because of the reduction of the transistor size, the transistor characteristics started degrading. Okay, and it's fine that to increase the number of transistors, you have to reduce the transistor size, but at the same time, you have to also ensure that the transistor characteristics is also excellent. Okay, so to maintain the excellent electrical characteristics, with a reduced dimension transistors, okay, lot of innovation in the transistor structures has already been done, and you see that the transistor structure has been modified over the years. Okay, and now are the state of art technology, which is you can see that 10 nanometer or 7 nanometer technology node, the transistor structures have been completely modified. Although still it is it will include a MOS capacitor, metal oxide semiconductor, and two region source and drain, but the appearance wise, you see that the structure has been modified just to improve its performance at the even at with the miniaturized size. Okay, so in this slide, just I wanted to show you that how over the year transistor size has been modified. So a very simplified pictures are shown. You can see that in first picture, let us assume that it is a classical MOSFET that we have talked about, drain region, source region, we have gate region, and then here it will be body region. Okay, then this was modified. Another structure was thought of, that was to build transistors on silicon on insulator, to develop transistors using silicon on insulator substrate. So then came the concept of SOI MOSFET, PDSY MOSFET, FDSY MOSFET. Okay, and later on, even those structures modified and more gate controls over the channel was required. So number of the gates are increased in the transistor. So from single gate SOI FET, it became double gate SOI FET, FinFET, tri-gate FET, where there are three gates surrounding the channel. Then there are quad gates where the channel region is surrounded by the gates from all four sides. Then these are nanowire FETs. So you see that the channel region is in a form of nanowire. You see, just look at this structure, okay? This gray color is a channel region which is surrounded by this gate. This yellow color is gate. Okay, so gate is surrounding the channel from all four sides. And this is your source region, this is your drain region. Okay, source contact and the drain contact. Of course, the source region will be this. Okay, the source region will be this. Drain region is this. This is source contact, the drain contact. Okay, so what I wanted to tell you that over the year the transistor structure has been modified significantly just to improve its performance, and then there are now different kind of structures. So the last unit, second last unit of this course, will deal with some alternative MOSFET structures, and we'll also discuss how to model the electrical characteristics of those transistors. Okay, so with this we'll finish our today's lecture. Okay, and I am open to take some more questions if you have based on these lectures. Okay. So no more question from anybody? Okay. All of you are fine with this? Okay, thank you very much. If even if you have any question, you can drop in my you can drop your message in WhatsApp group. Okay, I would love to answer that question at the beginning of the first ne next class. Okay, thank you very much. Thank you to all. Okay. Thank you all.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Oh.